session. Just to set a little bit of context as to why we're here. As some of you may know, India has a population of about 253 million young people, making it one of the largest demographics in the country. Over 12 million of these young people are set to join and enter the job market every year over the next few decades. And so keeping that in mind, it's evident that the employability sector in India is in crisis and that COVID-19 has significantly exacerbated this challenge. At this point, therefore, we feel like it's really important to closely examine these challenges and therefore the opportunities that exist in the space of employability and entrepreneurship for young people specifically. So we'd like to take a little bit of a step back, highlight the experiences of a young entrepreneur, and highlight the need for a more holistic and inclusive approach to entrepreneurship for, and for young people's futures. I'd like to introduce my three panelists. I have Olivia Deka with me, who's an entrepreneur and the founder of She for Change, which is a nonprofit organization working specifically to empower young girls in India with entrepreneurial and leadership skills. I have Dr. Zoya Rizvi, who is the Deputy Commissioner for Adolescent Health at the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, with a focus on health programs and women's empowerment programs. I also have Priya Varadarajan, who is the lead for gender justice and persons with disability clusters at the Azim Premji Philanthropic Initiatives, and is also the founder of a women's empowerment organization named Durga. Hi, everybody. Welcome. Really excited to have you here. To start off with, I think it's really important for us to take a step back and evaluate a little bit about the ecosystem around young entrepreneurs to understand what are the gaps that exist. Since building entrepreneurship skills takes a village, it's not just about young people. It's about schools and families and resources. And so to begin, Olivia, could you tell us a little bit, as an entrepreneur and also the founder of a program that's focused specifically on building these skills, what are some of the key challenges and the gaps that you've seen in young people's ability to become entrepreneurs? And could you also tell us a little bit about how COVID has exacerbated these challenges?
Yeah, so I guess the first challenge, you know, for any young person or any young, you know, even teenager to start their entrepreneurial endeavor is all about what the environment, what kind of environment they are in. Like, you know, if, are they in college or school, and are the teachers supportive, you know, are their friends supportive, are their parents supportive enough? So I guess these are the first initial, you know, like initial setback that most often young people face, because parents and, you know, their ecosystem around them do not encourage them to, you know, dive and go forward with entrepreneurship. So, and if they overcome that challenge, I think the next challenge becomes, you know, they're young enough. So our, you know, government regulations, business regulations, you know, finding and finance especially is one of the most key areas, because now this young person who probably wants to have, you know, has some great idea or has a great innovation, but do not have the sufficient funds, do not have savings, do not have other, you know, source of finance to invest in the business. Now, since he or she do not have a means to finance his or her business, how do they find the right employee for the business? So it's all interlinked, you know, that you do not have enough finance, so you cannot pay your employees. Then other employees who might join your startup, the core founding team or the initial, you know, 4 or 5 young people or friends that you can convince to join you, I guess they also go through the same challenges as you in terms of, you know, convincing their parents and saying that I want to go for startup. So I think this is one of the key big picture of what is happening.
So Charita, you're on mute.
Yeah.
Sorry. Could you talk a little bit more also about access to technology as one of the big challenges? Because I know that the distribution of tech across the country is so irregular that it's important to kind of address that as well.
Yeah, absolutely. So when I started my journey, I guess I was so inspired by so many young change makers who, so I don't see entrepreneurship as just someone starting a business, you know, just someone who has been running a business or who has a business idea, but anyone and everyone who has this amazing entrepreneurial spirit to do something different. So someone with the entrepreneurial mindset. So I think when I saw what inspired me to, you know, start my journey was the fact that I met a lot of young girls from very remote areas of this country, and the kind of work they have been doing in those, you know, corners of the country, is incredible. But again, they do not have access to technology. You know, they are from quite marginalized sections of the community. So people don't know about the stories, you know, people don't know what they are doing. And probably the scale and scope of the work that they are doing, it can be much greater, provided they had this, you know, boost of technology that we all have, most of the people have from urban areas. Yeah.
Definitely. And I think some of those gaps that you mentioned, that they're in remote areas, they don't have access to technology. I feel like it's also, there are, when you really examine the situation, much more fundamental gaps as well in access to things like basic nutrition, access to healthcare, access to menstrual hygiene products. And I think the pandemic has also made it more evident that accessing these resources is harder now than it has ever been before. And so we're also thinking about then the interlinkages between these things. If you're not healthy, can you really work? Can you start a business? Do you have those resources? And I think what we're also seeing is that the government is also noticing these interlinkages. The launch of the school health program, where they're bringing together access to education and access to healthcare for children and kind of using that as an avenue to address these issues, means that there is more to it than we're realizing. It's not just about skills. And so Dr. Rizvi, could you talk a little bit more about, in your opinion, what role does young people's health and well-being, especially access to nutrition, access to sexual and reproductive health and rights, play in building that enabling environment for young people? Dr. Rizvi, you're on mute.
Yeah. Okay. I would just like to, I think, thank everybody who's attending this webinar, and to begin by saying that Sucharita took words out of my mouth. I was going to say those lines, that if you're not healthy, how will you work? So what I would say is that investment in young children, young boys and girls, is in everybody's interest, right? Their parents, their teachers, the community, entire, everybody's involved and should invest in young people. And we have to realize that the foundation of good health, of adequate growth and development, is not really in adolescence. It begins way before. So if a girl is unhealthy and she gets pregnant, so the health will depend on the mother's health, the what kind of diet she has during her pregnancy, then what is the kind of diet she has during her childhood, and then of course during adolescence. So the foundation of growth actually begins much earlier than adolescence. So we need to start investing in nutrition for women, and healthy men, of course, that is equally important. And you all may be aware about this, there's a study which was published by Lancet, which said that if you invest, say, 100 rupees in a child now, in an adolescent now, you'll reap three times that benefit, but because you will avert so many adolescent morbidities and mortalities. So that is the kind of evidence which we have for investment in adolescent and youth, for the government, for even the civil society organizations. And what a lot of people actually quote and say that adolescents are our future, but we believe that adolescents are our present. So you have to invest in adolescents now and not look at the future, because there, if you invest in their health now, then they will be healthier adults. You know, their health is as important now as it will be later on also. So to have positive impact on India's, on the government's health goals and achievements, we have to invest in them now. And as Sucharita, you mentioned about malnutrition, anemia, and SRH, I would just like to give a brief background, is that our NFHS data, National Family Health Survey, which takes place almost every 5 to 10 years, that shows that more than 50% of girls are anemic, about 30% of boys are anemic. So that is the kind of large number, this translates into large numbers of adolescents who are suffering from chronic malnutrition, anemia, which is actually adversely affecting their health and then adversely affecting their development and their goals and their achievements in life. So that is the background with which we start. And this high rate of malnutrition and anemia, especially in girls, this ends up contributing to an intergenerational cycle of malnutrition. This leads to a poor health in the mother herself, in her child, low birth weight, children. So it's an ongoing cycle of intergenerational malnutrition, anemia, and this ultimately leads to lost economic opportunities for this young girl and for her child as well. So it's not just a girl who's malnourished, but her child is also malnourished, and this child will actually not live up to the full potential and will not perform to the best of its aptitudes. And if you look at the SRH background, we know that what is the lethal, the main inability of adolescent is to access good and adequate family planning procedure, family planning facilities and commodities, and of course menstrual hygiene, sanitary napkins. So if there is lack of availability, this leads to early unplanned parenthood. Then lack of access to contraception will also lead to, you know, trying unusual, irregular commodities which are available in the market, which are not actually thoroughly investigated and used, and may even lead to unsafe abortions. So that is also something which is wrong. And this will also end up leading to higher rates of reproductive tract infection and STIs also. And all this, if you look at all the gamut of all the lack of access to SRH, this will lead to lack of improvement in educational, economic, social status of women, primarily of women. And even any kind of STI, RTI in a boy also will affect his total outcome in education and economic outcomes. So if what government feels is that if this unmet need, say the unmet need of contraception, of access to sanitary napkins, of access to iron folic supplementation, if that is met, we are looking at a huge, I think, economic, social cost which can be saved for our adolescent who will end up being unhealthy later on. So investment is now giving them appropriate access to commodities, to services, so that they end up being healthy adults. And I would just take one step back to mention just one point. We have missed out on something, which is mental health. Mental health is an overarching thing which is really affected by both your access to SRH and access to nutrition. So mental health is an important intervention which the government is really working on, especially with COVID in the background. A lot of interventions are being put into place by the governments, by the CSOs and our partner NGOs in the government. So yes, I think that importance is to invest in adolescents now, because their health is important now. That's all. Yeah. Over to you, Sucharita.
No, and I think you've made some really important points, especially about mental health. I think being able to work or being able to, you know, start a business requires so much presence of mind and so much mental work that I think not addressing mental health would really be a miss in such a conversation. And I think the other thing that you mentioned that's really important is the social and the cultural aspect of it, giving young people access to sexual and reproductive health and rights, breaking those taboos around menstruation, around sex. I think those are such important aspects to actually enabling young people to really go out and make choices that benefit them. And so it's also important to think a little bit about what are these young people facing as challenges socially. Because they're not young people because they're such a massive group. They're also not a monolithic body. Mm-hmm. So many people in different parts of the country are facing different kinds of challenges, are at different intersections, are facing different forms of marginalization. And so it's important to kind of build that lens into how we work on young people's employability. And Priya, I wanted to ask you, how do you think we can better do that? How do you think we can kind of incorporate this lens of inclusivity and intersectionality into our work to ensure that young people are employable and are able to become
entrepreneurs? So this is a very, very important topic, and I may just go on and on. So please do stop me when I'm just on a spiel. So good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much to the organizers for the opportunity, especially Team Dasra. It is a very critical conversation. I'm personally delighted that despite all odds, we've been able to, you know, somehow reinvent as a race, and so many important conversations happening parallelly and continuing to happen successfully as well. So thank you also to the other panelists for the insightful points you've raised. So in the way the world is today, I think most young people, especially in places like India, cannot afford to be without jobs, and now more than ever. So recently there was a study that was done by CMIE in Mumbai, and that says that more than 1.8 crore salaried employees have actually lost their jobs because of the pandemic, and at least 50 lakh of them have just been reported in July itself. So the number of salaried jobs, one of the most secure forms of employment, are expected to decline over the next few months. So if you're looking at this as a state for urban India, I just can't imagine what the state would be in the rest of the country, right? So even if for a brief second, we were to say that the informal sector or parts of rural India may be slightly less impacted, and I'm saying wishfully, then I will argue actually that there's a double whammy for the informal sector. So one is they face all the direct loss of, you know, jobs or livelihood and everything that they anyway suffer. And then also because of urban unemployment and lack of cash flows or limited cash flows from urban or the formal sector, it sort of impacts the informal sector anyway. So we are at the brink of an overall sort of reduced spending, poverty, recession. And if we don't balance the purchasing power of people, I'm not sure what's going to really happen. I'm told repeatedly by many of our partners in the philanthropy that many of the youth programs, especially the those that are targeted towards girls, have already gone down and they've actually taken a reverse beating. And most of the work, if at all things normalize sooner, will have to start afresh like nothing was, you know, started or done itself. And this is not just for India. So a real reimagination is the need of the hour. I understand people in the margins of mainstream society, as you say, are those who fall in the periphery because of their economic background, class, caste, and religion, and hence lose their rights and entitlements because of where they are or who they are. So this becomes the crux of the work in the development sector to basically ensure that there's overall development, but as well as individual development, and special efforts need to go towards the individual development that I'm talking about. So unless our thinking shifts as implementers of large programs to see that while we design programs for vulnerable people, we need to design programs that benefit not just a target community, but everyone in that space. So programs should include everyone and should be for the benefit of everyone. Young people are really the only hope, and I'm not, you know, wanting to sound cliche, but they are our future and they are our present, and that's the only truth that we have today. So with the pandemic now, the ones to be mostly affected are the already marginalized, and among them, the gender disadvantaged, and among them, youth, and particularly young girls, are right on top. Young people, especially girls, will face several challenges: access to each other, to safe spaces, to education, to peer engagement. All of this is a huge problem. Excessive time at home means excessive work at home, being a part of abusive environments at home, and also high risk of marriage and childbirth at an inappropriate age. If all the opportunity and access to the needs are provided or available, what next? How can you build on it? What happens to jobs, to opportunity, and to livelihoods from there? Youth need to be empowered. Independence and knowledge are huge tools for this empowerment. And as without them, decision-making and making something of their lives is impossible. Without this, moving out of vulnerabilities also becomes impossible. So in order to do this, I think it is imperative we use the lens of understanding them better, both youth and their skill, and what use they can put the skill to becomes imperative. So while governments are building opportunities for employment for youth in general, it is imperative as civil society that we look at needs of youth who are in the margins, who are otherwise missed in every part of the program, and because of which they miss opportunities. The way we go about this will be to build programs with inclusivity. We envisage the entire journey of the individual rather than look at the program as a project. If we build a program keeping the individual at the center, I think that in itself will be the right lens to start with. But what are we doing instead today? We build programs on ensuring schooling happens. We build programs on ensuring health and nutrition happens. If this is done and there's still some lack of funding, we will build programs on vocational training, counseling, and showcasing opportunities and some bits more. But how many of these programs are meaningful if we don't have the next steps of jobs for youth? As an example, the biggest argument for overall well-being for girls is that they should ensure that they are in school till class 12 and then push their age of marriage and then in turn age-appropriate pregnancies and so on. So this is what we really see. What does this really mean? That the objective or the role for girls is to eventually get married and have children, and all we're doing is push that age? And is that what is important? And why is that empowerment at all? Or how do we look at that as empowerment? I think programming needs to change. The age-old way of doing things will not work now. There are too many irreversible and damaging factors now than ever before. It's a bad economic slump, it's reduced jobs anyway, it's the pandemic, and issues which are more wicked than these, which could be patriarchy or climate change, and all these need to be factored in when we are looking at our program. The lens to be used instead would be to ensure that the girl or the individual gets all the education till class 12 and then has the additional vocational training required to get a job, and actually also has the highest opportunity to actually get placed in a job. That will be really transformational for them. So the lens will really be to place the individual in the center, like I was emphasizing earlier. This would mean in the programming world, understanding the communities and their issues, seeing what is the need for them, providing education and vocational skill, actually going through with the last mile of ensuring that the parents are connected with the cause and actually see their youth and their families to be able to bring back benefit into their family through livelihoods and economic benefit. And then actually being able to place people on the jobs. So programming will mean that there should be social enterprise models that actually connect skilled to the job, think through market-based solutions that actually work on their own. As Olivia was talking about, access to technology becomes important, and move beyond the idea of education leads to empowerment to instead saying employment leads to empowerment of a different kind. It could be through fellowships, it could be creating frameworks for youth on rights and duties, aligning them with constitutional values. The lens of inclusivity is definitely needed to ensure that everyone in the geography is covered, no matter who they are and where they come from. This means sexual minorities, this means gender minorities, this means religious backgrounds, caste, class deprived. And I'm actually saying everyone. And how does this happen? It will not happen because the head of the organization says it. Sorry, I'll just, my last point and I'll stop.
Yes.
It's because it is the right thing to do. You know, it comes only when the teams, especially on the field, are able to do it. The hiring of organizations should change from an inclusive perspective. Leadership should be inclusive. Programming outcomes should be measured with the lens of disaggregated data. Only then you will know that you have reached all who needed to be reached and started to create change. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Priya. Those were some really, really important points. And I think talking especially of like changing the end goal from being get a girl educated to get her employed, employable, and able to kind of stay in that space, I think that's a huge shift. And it's one that I think is very, very fundamental to how we see and perceive these programs. And I think that also lays the foundation for a little bit of understanding the way forward. Now that we know this, I think a lot of us in a lot of different places have already kind of understood that the current approach isn't working and that we need to look at things a little bit more holistically. We need to take a little bit of a step back. We need to really reevaluate the way we're designing and carrying out these programs. And so, Olivia, I wanted to ask, based on the work that you've done and the programs that you've run and also the young girls that you've worked with, what have you found to be most catalytic? What are some of the things that you've worked on or that you've seen have been most effective in helping young people change their mindset and helping even the people around them kind of shift from, you know, learning skills to learning technical skills to be employed to something a little bit more dynamic?
Yeah. So, you know, as I was saying, that skills these days are easily available, you know, and you can go to YouTube and you can learn a skill provided you have access to technology. So what we as an organization in She for Change work in is the fact that young girls need role models first, they need mentors, they need sponsors, and they need a safe, inclusive space that where they can thrive, you know, and they can thrive with each other. They can find peer buddies, you know, that they can talk to. So our programs are designed in a way where a Teach for India, you know, kid from a Teach for India school or any other, you know, nonprofit, we partner up with other nonprofits when, you know, kids come from a really marginalized background. So a kid from those backgrounds and a kid studying in an international school or studying in a DPS or a heritage school in Delhi can sit together, they work together, they come up with projects together, and, you know, their parents are engaged, their parents knows what is going on. And at the end of the program, as ma'am was saying, as Priya ma'am was saying, that how can we employ them? So we take them through a three-month program, and post that, we see where we can get them engaged, you know, can they do an internship? Can they do a fellowship? Can they, you know, just assist us if they are underage, you know, let's say a girl is 13 or 14 and probably organizations will not hire her for internships or probably fellowships do not exist, you know, in that age group where she's 13 or 14 and might not be as, she might not be able to give that much time. So we again engage her, we, you know, see if she is willing to do a social impact project for her community, and then again guide her through, you know, doing that through our different programs that we have. So our the range of programs, the range of initiatives that She for Change takes, one thing leads to the other. You know, you start building their skills, you make them, you know, you give them an opportunity, just a platform to utilize those skills that they have learned or the mindset that they have cultivated. You know, just being responsible enough, just being, you know, punctual enough for the classes, just, you know, being collaborative enough, just talking out, just speaking their opinions, you know, those things. And then we take them through other programs, which are, you know, a kind of more sort of, needs more, you know, time and commitment and effort. But that is the whole module. Like, what we are preparing is that we are preparing girls to be brave enough, teenage girls to be brave enough, to be courageous enough, find friends, find mentors, and then have the ability to do something on their own, you know, like say that I own this, this is my, you know, project, and I'm going to do whatever I can with this. And I know that there's a support ecosystem around me, which is going to support me. So I think I won't say that, you know, this is what every organization should follow. But I think, as ma'am was saying, the programming, how you design the program is of, it's very important. And how you define your output, how you define your outcome is exceptionally important. How your team members, you know, any organization who's taking such initiative, how the team members are aligned to the end goal or the outcome is very important. So we take less girls, we give more time, and we are making sure that we are, it's not numbers for us. We are an NGO, and most NGOs, to be honest, you know, are looking at numbers, are looking at the scale of impact. Funders and organizations who are providing the impact funds are looking at numbers again. What we are doing is we are saying that, you know, we do not want numbers. What we want is real impact, real life-changing experience. And I mean, that's the whole of it. I think we are looking at scale, we are looking at growth, but right now the core mission is that any girl who comes and joins She for Change program should feel that, you know, she has had gone through a transformation journey.
That's absolutely wonderful. And I think just the idea of, as a young girl, feeling like you're able to hold something and own it and completely kind of believe in it, that is such a wonderful concept. And I have a small follow-up question. What do you think has been most catalytic in your own journey of setting up Shift Change? Like, what is, say, one factor that you think has really changed the game for you?
Yeah, for me, I think it has been, again, opportunities, you know, just pure exposure and opportunities is really, really catalytic. Like, it has, the moment someone recognizes the work you are doing and you are able to take a step forward and move in that journey, and there are support ecosystem around you, it's highly empowering. So I think the most important and catalytic, you know, element for any young person to be really thriving and be successful and, you know, do whatever they do with passion, with commitment, is that they have the right mentors, they have the right support ecosystem, and that they are getting the opportunities, that their stories are being told, you know, that they are, you know, they are shown that whatever they are doing is of value and that people around them value it. So that is why I keep on emphasizing on the fact that, you know, telling the stories and bringing the stories of young people is so important, because, you know, when no one around you believes you, article featured about you can change, you know, can like keep you on track for months. It looks very, you know, something very trivial and shallow. But trust me, when your parents, your friends, your, you know, teachers are doubting you, but there's someone recognizing the work you are doing and saying that, you know, we value the kind of work that you are doing. A kid who's all alone, probably struggling and, you know, trying to make something happen because they're passionate about it, it provides a huge morale for them. And yeah, exactly. Like, you know, a lot of people then reaches out. So a support network is also built. So.
No, I completely agree. And I think, like you said, like the value of that one person believing in you, you don't ever really know how much of an impact that will make. And I think the fact that you're working to build that and also build it for these girls by giving them a network of each other is really, really incredible. And I think it also kind of speaks to a little bit of, this can't be just empowering girls. It has to be looking at all of the stakeholders around young people, looking at schools, looking at their parents, looking at the community. And it needs to be, like you said, it needs to be something that happens at scale, and it needs to be like a systemic change also. to and how we perceive employability and entrepreneurship and building these skills for young girls. And of course, such an activity at such a large scale cannot happen without the government and without kind of working in sync with the government's priorities. And so, Dr. Rizvi, as we know, this is a priority for the government, and we are also looking at ways to ensure that we're addressing young people's needs as holistically and as completely as possible, despite all of the things that are making it difficult. And can you talk a little bit about how we, as a development sector, as philanthropists, as private players, can kind of contribute to and support what the government is doing to ensure that young people are able to be more employable?
Okay. Now, I think this time I'm unmuted. Yeah. Okay. See, what happens is that government is running a lot of programs for the health of adolescent, for the health of children, and implementation is basically broadly through the government paraphernalia and the whole systems in place. However, where we require support of the CSOs, of partners, is more for maybe technical support, which you can give in implementation of programs. You can do maybe hand-holding during trainings. You can do hand-holding during mentoring of our, especially I would just give a reference of the school health program, which we have. School health program, I mean, many of you may not be aware, it is a very ambitious program in which we are looking to access about 260 million children who go to school in India. And that is covered across millions of schools. So for this year, year one, what we are doing is we are looking at covering about 1.1 lakh schools this year. And we are looking to train two teachers per school. So two teachers per school, because we have realized that a lot of skills which children have, whether it is agency, whether it is self-betterment ideas, whether it is improving oneself, those skills gradually develop from schools only. So that is an area for huge impact when we want to improve any kind of health, any kind of attitude, or even knowledge of children. So keeping that in the background, we have looked to train two teachers per school. And just for your information, we've got these wonderful, very interesting themes, 11 themes on which we are training. There is growing up healthy, there is emotional well-being and mental health, there's interpersonal relationships, values and responsible citizenship, gender equality, nutrition, health, sanitation, prevention and management of substance abuse, promotion of healthy lifestyle, reproductive health and HIV prevention, safety and security against violence and injuries, and finally, promotion and safe use of internet. So these have been thought, I think we spent quite a lot of time in coordination with the Ministry of Education as to how we will roll it out. So that is where it is already, we have already done, state master trainers have been created across for 1.1 lakh schools. We have about 1800 master trainers for states which are created. And now is the time when the states are going ahead. And with the COVID in the background, a lot of partners are supporting us in implementation of this this program, this very ambitious program, because I think this program is something which will support, will encourage our children to think, because what has come in this program is a lot of interactive case studies, there are a lot of small quizzes, a lot of discussions, which again make the child think. And that is what we have realized, that once the children learn to think for themselves, when they learn to innovate things and innovate on themselves, and like Olivia mentioned, it's a beautiful thought which she mentioned, is when somebody starts believing in you, that's a very important thing. And that is something which we hope to achieve, is that at the school, the child will be inspired to think, maybe think outside the box, think for himself, herself, and that kind of support, if that is translated at home as well, if the family members understand the child, if they help the child to develop, I think just an ability to question, just the ability to question why this is happening like this and not like this. If that thing starts from home and is encouraged in school, that will help us bring about a generation of young boys and girls who will have the power to change and improve things the way it is being implemented. So with that background, this is happening. And in this, we are, like you mentioned, Sucharita, about the partners. So what is happening now is about when the states are going ahead and doing the training of the health and wellness ambassadors, which these two teachers in schools are going to be caused. That's where the partners are supporting us. They're giving technical support to the states. They're helping managing, you know, how to arrange the trainings. Now with COVID, a lot of states are doing online training. Some states are going ahead and doing physical training with adequate distance. So that kind of support, that kind of, I think, partnership is really being strengthened in states. And a partner like you mentioned, whether it's DASRA, we have got partners like UNICEF, we've got UNFPA, we've got JIPAIGO, which is present in, which is supporting us in 12 states. So that's, I think that kind of involvement is there with the government, that this program being so critical for growing children. This is the present and future, like I mentioned, I always go back to the present and future. So this support which the partners are giving, and I think other partners who are also in the field, whether it is DASTA supported, USAID, they all are there, and this kind of support will help government in bringing across this change through schools. Because I think we have taken one solid decision that if health and education partner together and provide the right information to the children in schools through teachers, that will have a great effect. And that will multiply, that will have a multiply effect more so, because these children will go back to their houses and impart the similar education in houses and within the community. So we're looking at a huge wave of behavioral change, knowledge acknowledgement, and information distribution within communities. And that will, I think, support greater thinking and innovative skills for our children. And then as this whole webinar is about entrepreneurship, I would say that these children will start, I think, realizing that it's not just about money. It's about innovation. It's about working to improve your own environment, your own village, your own city. So that will make them think and come out with new ideas. And that, if supported by NGOs and CSOs, that will go a long way. Like I think Priya mentioned about APPI, which is funding, which is seeing where to fund, what to do. So if these young children come out with ideas, I don't see why partners and the supporters and the funders will not go ahead and support these children in bringing these ideas onto the ground and see it multiply, scale up, and do wonders.
Yeah. Amazing. I think that also really puts into perspective the fact that there is already so much amazing work going on the ground, in partnership with the government, in partnership with philanthropists, and that, you know, it's not that we're starting from nothing. It's not that nobody is doing things. There is so much wonderful work going on to kind of already give these young people some of the resources that they need to hopefully not so far in the future actually take back some of the power. Before we move on, do we have any questions from the audience? We have one question. Each of the panelists have talked a lot about creating enabling environments. How would this apply to vulnerable communities specifically? Priya, I think this would be a really good question for you to answer. Priya, you're on mute.
Yeah, I'm just looking at the question. So how, in your opinion, would this apply to vulnerable communities particularly? So I was going to talk about it anyway. So what I think is important is that the safe space that we're talking about for youth is extremely critical, you know. So as youngsters, and we've all been through that space, right, and that age of being able to share, to be ourselves, that nurtures and fortifies us more than just education or certain things which could end of the day become more transactional. So I think this whole, and Olivia was also alluding to the same thing, the fact that you have a peer community, you have leaders there, you have people who have been through the same phase as you, who have actually done something and achieved something for themselves, they become fantastic mentors. Many times I've seen, and even in my personal experience within the organization that I run as well, there's only, while we're talking about, say, issues of safety, there's only that much that a facilitator or a teacher can do. What wonders one, sees happening on the ground is what the peer leaders have taught, or what the mentors have taught, or what the child or the girl actually sees from what their environment teaches them. And that becomes very, very critical. So many adolescent programs, for instance, happen with collectivization. So bring girls together, give them opportunity to talk, share, be themselves, create that space where, you know, they can actually voice their opinion, and then see wonders happen automatically. The only thing that's important here is that there should be some method in it. There should be some consistency in it and a regularity. And then after a stage, I think the group takes over the, you know, essence of the program, and things start happening on its own. Of course, it's not as romantic as I'm saying when it really plays out on the ground, but it works.
Amazing. Olivia, would you like to maybe tell us about any examples of a similar of programs that have holistically supported communities? Maybe not necessarily for adolescents, but I think overall, to bring about some of this change. Olivia, we're not able to hear you very clearly.
Is it fine now?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Now it's better.
Okay. So I think there are multiple examples that I can give. One of my favorite organization, I think, would be Teach for All and Teach for India. And the way they, you know, the way the entire system and the entire program is created, how Teach for India fellows become literally become these didis and bhaiyas here for the young children. And they are so invested in the kids, right? I think second example that I can give is my own community of Ashoka. So Ashoka Innovators for Public is a global organization, and it has this Young Changemakers program. It has also, it is one of, also one of the, you know, leading organization in the space of social entrepreneurship, has been in the ecosystem for last 40 years, creating, you know, empowering social entrepreneurs across the globe. And Ashoka fellows are said to be the, you know, most system changing entrepreneurs out there. So, they also have this Young Changemaker program, which is again a very, very diverse community of teenagers from 12 to 20 from across the world, you know, doing amazing things in their community. And I am one of the Young Changemakers. So I have gone through the kind of support that Ashoka provided me, helped me to start my organization, Shape for Change. So I think like these two organizations, and there are multiple, you know, again, Boss Foundation does a lot of work in Europe, and then similarly there are other organizations out there doing incredible work for creating this whole system change, you know, empowering adolescents and young people and under 30, you know, people to create this, to bring, to co-create, you know, to facilitate more co-creation among different entrepreneurs or change makers, to facilitate more collaboration among you know, entrepreneurs, and not just in within a country, but also globally, like cross-country collaborations. So I guess, you know, there are a lot of things happening. There are organizations doing amazing work. And yeah, hopefully, you know, we can see more of that.
Definitely. I think that would be wonderful. Priya, I think you've touched upon this a little bit, and Dr. Rizvi has as well. But I think what would be really interesting to also understand is, how can we push philanthropists to kind of take this lens a little bit more? I think this is a $1 million question, very literally, but it's, I think we do, there is kind of an understanding of why we need to do this and how we can do it. But I think what would be really interesting to know is really how can we push philanthropists to make decisions with this lens in mind?
Okay. So if unemployment continues, youth unemployment will, you know, sort of climb to about 32%. And this will definitely have like severe ramifications, right? Because it will increase poverty, it will increase mental health issues, it will also increase crime and, you know, whole lot of stuff. So efforts are required to create job opportunities and create jobs too, parallelly, because otherwise it's just not the direct connect. And civil society and government needs to be working together in this journey. Philanthropic funding can do as much as what organizations are doing on the ground. So yes, there are many philanthropies who have decided, like globally, to say that they want to take over some part of implementation themselves, but largely the support on the ground is financial support to organizations who are doing some great work out there. So it is important for philanthropies to have their own intended outcomes as well for issues that they want to fund. So if, for instance, you're looking at issues of adolescent girls, then it's important for philanthropy to understand where do they want to get through in this journey. So if they're looking at empowering young adults, then it is important for philanthropy also to fully understand what it means and what could be various efforts that need to go into this by civil society organizations and what is already available for these efforts through government schemes like Dr. Rizvi was alluding to. So what is to be done? How does this journey work? Who is working in this journey and whom do we need to partner because we want to get to that outcome is extremely important for philanthropy to engage in. It's not that, you know, you have funding, so you just go and give funding to some project. So development really means building a nation full of young thinkers, and they in turn will translate their thinking and knowledge to action at some stage. And if they get all the fortification they need, this is exactly what will really happen. So unless this vision in this context exists with philanthropies, and unless this is shared and shared vision with civil society, nothing can really happen on the ground. So funding in itself will only do that much. It's important that we take the implementer and the community on board. So philanthropic funding, as I see, can be used by civil society in perhaps some of these ways. So we have to hear young people to know more on what they really need. Where do they want to go?
maybe we could invest more money in actually doing some studies, very detailed research on what is the real need and where's the Indian economy today, and how do we, considering all the things that are happening, how can we actually collectively take people with us? Can funding be actually more invested towards proof of concept, validation, doing more pilots, so that organizations and civil societies have the luxury to experiment rather than function? Otherwise, we will ourselves as philanthropies, you know, keep saying that why are organizations funding like a project to project mode? Why are they not innovating? They will innovate, but where's the funding? No? So funding should be put into that direction. Funding can be given to scale. If things are going well, then why are we not funding to scale? Not just scale a program, but scale in the idea, scale the thinking, scale to, you know, fund scale to say that if it's working in this context, what more should be done to leverage this platform where something can happen at a different level somewhere? Maybe funders should also come together, talk to each other more, build a consortium to say, okay, you are looking at this element of the program. Maybe some other element is missing here, which I am invested in, because you and I can actually go together, you know, and go that mile together. So that kind of talking together as funders, while it's happening, is also happening in small spaces. I think there should be collective, like, you know, funder consortium to ensure that you know, adolescent girls programs work, or consortiums for gender-based violence programs. So this will really sort of help in the outcomes. Otherwise, we'll just continue to work in silos. Fellowship funding is extremely important, because, and I think fellowship should be looked at differently from the way we are looking at fellowships for social entrepreneurships. Fellowship for any kind of change at a local level should be done, even within the Azeem Premji Philanthropy, while we're looking at adolescent girls as receivers of service because of various kinds of vulnerabilities they face. We're increasingly looking at programs that actually look at adolescent girls as real change makers. You know, what could be that little shift that a program can do to make that girl an enabler of a lot of social change rather than just sort of receiver of benefits? Maybe training of trainer programs, you know, all of these could collectively kill, you know, build like a cadre of youth leaders. All of this, I think, are small changes, but changes in the mindset of funders to really believe in what is happening at the implementation level, have faith in them, and give. And I'm really emphasizing on the word give. I hope I've answered that.
Yes, I think that was actually a very, very insightful and very helpful answer. Dr. Rizvi, you wanted to add?
Yeah, I've been hearing Priya, and I'm so impressed by her, you know, giving things she's saying. That's really positive coming from a donor herself, you know. So what I would just like to just stress a couple of things which you mentioned also, Priya, is that you must not have donors who are implementing part, you know, parts of a program. You know, it's like one donor is implementing something on SRH only, you know, and they're not worried about mental health, associated mental health, or associated gender-based violence. So like the consortium which Priya excellently mentioned, and which I think Dasha is also working on, is that you have a conglomeration of donors. And then you say, okay, if you need to do something on adolescent, I would say boys are equally important, because with this COVID thing, there's a huge incidence of whether it is abuse at home, whether it's physical violence, and a lot of boys are affected. So we need to invest in boys as well. For us, adolescent boys as important as an adolescent girl. So any intervention, if you're looking at, say, access to safe sexual practices, access to maybe sanitary napkins, you're saying, or IFA, or some kind of mental health counseling, it has to go hand in hand with other interventions for the same, for the similar beneficiary population. So that is something which we should work together, rather than, you know, one intervention only which doesn't talk to the other intervention. So that has to be, I think, like closed door discussions, which Priya mentioned, you need to get together. So anybody who's investing in health of a child or a mother, whatever, that has to, you know, be in touch with anybody else who's investing in any other part of that person. So that is something which is really important. I mean, I just wanted to put that point across.
No, that makes complete sense. I think it has to, you have to kind of make sure that everything ties back into each other. Otherwise, you're never really going to be able to see that, like, broader change when you take a step back. We have another really interesting audience question, which is, how do programs and organizations working with or for adolescents perceive crowdfunding as a source of pilot financing? Olivia, would you like to maybe give that a shot?
Yeah, crowdfunding definitely is our go-to, like, especially for young entrepreneurs, especially someone like me who started in college, because, you know, as ma'am said, there were a lot of experimentations. You know, initially, whenever you come up with an idea, you have to run a pilot, you have to test it out, you have to see the scale and scope. you have to see if you can actually, you know, if you are at a position to get the money or even ask for the money. So at that point of time, crowdfunding and, you know, other sources of funding, like, you know, just doing your own fundraiser and just, you know, getting probably individual philanthropist who wants to, you know, who relates to your cause and wants to give it to you. These kind of different mediums are the first go-to sources for sure. I mean, it's incredibly helpful for you to especially experiment and not having the owner's key. You have to like show the impact or tell the other person or probably write a, you know, 10-page report on what is happening, right? So when you do not have the bandwidth to all do all these compliances and all these other formalities, that's when you are not a registered organization, probably when you are just, you know, when you have started and you haven't registered it, it's incredibly difficult to get funding.
Right, of course. And a follow-up question to that, which is, how can we measure, or how can organizations measure intangible aspects of impact? How, like measuring agency or empowerment, and how can we kind of track that to be able to also show it as a proof of concept, like Priya, you were saying. Do you have any tips and tricks that you'd like to share?
So I'm happy to go because it's a very, very important and interesting thing, because also where I work in Durga, we're talking about deterrence of sexual harassment or violence and abuse, right? So how do you then actually measure, and can you actually say that there were three instances where I could have been abused and I, you know, sort of was able to do something about it? So it's very important to actually feed in or be prepared with proxy indicators. What are those issues or areas which I can measure to say that some intervention has been successful or not? So if you're talking about, say, something that has not happened, or if you're saying that a place has become safe for a, you know, a bunch of girls to occupy, then maybe have indicators to say what are the times, time of the day that girls are able to occupy that space. Are you actually able to see more women and girls in that space over a larger period of time? Also, you know, how do they think about the issue of feeling confident? So things like confidence can be measured. Things like what has been the baseline and end line of the, you know, sort of understanding and knowledge of the individual during the course of the program can definitely be measured. Proxy indicators like, you know, who's occupying that space, who's taking decisions, what kind of decisions have been taken. All of those are absolutely possible to look at. Things like empowerment and agency for a person. What kind of decisions has a girl taken post, you know, having that intervention? How has it changed from what she was taking in the past? So if you really think through and build it, you may not get tons of it, but you will definitely get two or three things which are very specific to the program and very measurable in some way.
Amazing. I think that is a really wonderful and very helpful note on which to end this panel. We're at our last 2 minutes. And so I first just want to say thank you very much to all three panelists. You've been wonderful. And I think your insights have really, really made this conversation a lot more valuable and very, very full of very rich insight. I think we're all kind of leaving with the takeaway that the first and most important thing is to hand power back to young people and to kind of make it possible for them to step up and shape the world to be whatever it is that they want it to be. And that to do so, it's about more than giving them just the technical skills, and it's about kind of making sure that we empower them, that we come together collaboratively to build an environment around them that allows them to make choices, to ask questions, and to really go out there and make informed choices. Thank you so much, everybody. Thank you for being here. And yeah, thank you so much.